Okay, I don't know how many of you tend to look at world news once in a while. I mean, not just the news that is happening around in India and around, but if you look at world news, especially in the last couple of years, if you see a great issue the people of the United States of America have been claiming about is anything that happens in the country, the president would basically talk about the gun problem. The reason everything is going on is because of the gun problem. Now, those of us in India don't understand why they have guns, because we don't have guns like them. Now, cultures are different, situations are different, so I'm not going to get into that whole idea. So what we do over here is so different. So when we look at them, we should not look at them from an Indian perspective. We need to see, we need to know their history. We need to know what happened to them from the very beginning of whenever they established themselves. So, but in the midst of this gun problem, the gun association people, when they were asked to give up their guns, they came out with a statement. I thought it was an interesting statement. They said, when these mass shootings were going on, they said, Cain killed Abel with a rock. It is not a gun problem, it is a heart problem. I mean, do you understand what I'm trying to say? For those of you who don't know who Cain and Abel is in the Bible, in the book of Genesis, chapter 4. They are the kids of Adam and Eve. So they said, Cain killed Abel with a rock. It's not a gun problem, it is a heart problem. So this morning I want to take a few minutes as we are in between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, and today and tomorrow, and basically 2 days, we're going to enter into Yom Kippur. The books are going to be closed in the heavenly court, and the Lord is going to make judgment for all of us. For the young, the old, the kings, the queens, the handmaidens, the servants, everybody, knowingly or unknowingly, will have to go through the judgment of God. Okay? So what is going to happen? I don't know, but we just believe that those of us who have kept our hearts true to God, that God will have mercy on behalf of Yeshua HaMashiach on our lives. Okay? Let's turn and look into the Bible, what the Bible talks about the heart. Jeremiah chapter 17, verses 9 and 10. Jeremiah chapter 17, verses 9 and 10. It says, the heart is most deceitful of all, and it is frail, or it is wicked, and who knows it? Isn't that true? In a way, what lies deep within our heart, what lies tucked away, who knows it? Verse number 10 says, I, Hashem, the Lord, your God, examines the heart. He tests the innermost parts in order to give man according to his ways the fruit of his deeds. It talks about God examining the heart, testing the innermost parts of our heart. You know, when God tests our heart, it's not like the X-ray machine. It's not like the sonogram. It's not like the CAT scan. What he tests is entirely different. So the question is, why is the heart deceitful? Or what makes the heart deceitful? Or what is it that exists inside the heart that makes it deceitful? I thought it was just a flesh, but the Bible talks about, when the Bible is talking, it's not just talking about the physical, it's talking something beyond. If you know a little bit of biology, the heart is just a pump. It just pumps blood. But this organ in our life, in our bodies, which pumps blood, what makes this heart evil? Let's see what Yeshua says. Matthew chapter 15, verses 19 to 20. Matthew chapter 15, verses 19 to 20. He says that from within the heart comes the impulse of evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornication, thefts, false testimonies, lying, scorning. Now we need to make something very clear over here. Yeshua is not saying that murder, theft, or adultery is what resides in the heart. It's like if you cut open your heart and open it, you won't be able to see murder, theft, and lying. That's not what he's trying to say. He's talking about what lies within the heart is the impulse of evil thoughts. It's not backstabbing. You can't see those things inside your heart. Then verse number 20 says, it is these evil thoughts, these are what contaminate a person. When Jesus is talking over here, he's not talking about the body, how it's going to be dirty. It's talking about the soul, how it becomes contaminated, how it becomes dirty. So the question is, where do the urge of these evil thoughts come from? Where do these evil thoughts come from? Can we go to Ratnadeep and get these evil thoughts in small packets? Can we go to the supermarket and buy murder, idolatry, lying, and just put it in? Where does this evil thought come from? We need to know, where does it come from? If you look in the book of Genesis, chapter 8, verse 21, Genesis chapter 8, verse 21, God tells us that one of the reasons why he will not curse the earth is because of the impulse of man's evil thoughts. This is around the time of Noah after the flood. He's saying, you know, I'm not going to curse the earth, is because of the impulse of the evil thoughts. See what it says in verse number 21. He says, and the Lord said to himself in his heart, I will not continue to curse the earth again because of man. Why? Since the impulse of man's heart is evil from his youth. What does that mean? Evil from his youth? The word youth teaches us that the impulse evil in man is from the beginning of their youth. So is the Bible saying that the evil comes from when I was young? The sages say that from the time a child desires to leave his or her mother's womb, the evil impulse is placed within him. From the time the child comes out into the world, each child, if you know, has a very strong personality. Each child is different, and this personality which the child tries to bring out is linked with the selfish desires within the child. Sometimes you wonder, why does a child behave such a way? Why is the child, you know, I don't get my way? Some child, you know, can fall on the ground, scream, yell, I'm not getting my way. Where did the child get this idea from doing that? Nobody's giving me attention, I'm just going to do whatever I want. Where does the child get this temper tantrums? You know what temper tantrums are, you know? Different children do it differently. Where does the child get it from? When you were young, you used to do it. Okay, how did your parents handle it? I don't know, you have to ask your parents. Yeah, now also people do. Even when you grow, we do it, it's just different. It's just that we have not learned to handle it, okay? So Genesis 8:21, when it says from his youth, the word from can also be translated as a result of his youth. This is why man's heart is evil. It is the youth that causes man to sin. It is in the youth, the impulsiveness of the youth causes one to sin. So So, Pastor, what are you saying? Are you saying the impulsiveness of my youth is the problem? I'm not young anymore. I've crossed my teenage years. Now, we need to understand the idea of the youth when the Bible talks about is beyond the infant. It is beyond the toddler. It is beyond the child. It is beyond the teenager. It is beyond the young adult. Even a 76 or 80 year old man can be going through the impulsiveness of his youth in his heart. Are you with me? So you're not, oh, I might be physically old, but even though you're physically old, you can see that the impulsiveness of your youth still goes on. That's why if you read the paper once in a while, you begin to see 80 year old man did something to 2 year old child. How does it happen? I thought he was a Buddha. But how does the Buddha do it? It's because of the impulsiveness of his heart. Okay? 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22. See what Paul says. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22. He says, flee from youthful lust and pursue righteousness, pursue faith, pursue love, pursue peace in your calling with the Master with a pure heart. What is a pure heart? A pure heart is a heart that is absent from certain types of impulsive evil. And Paul very clearly tells Timothy, you know, flee. We need to flee from the youthful lust. The Bible does not tell us when these evil appear in man. It tells us why these evil appear in man. Now, you need to understand, you and I are made in the image of God. And what is the image of God? The image of God is so majestic, it's so glorious, it's so infinite, it is without any imperfection. That means when God created you, there is no imperfection. And I'm saying imperfection, imperfection is not on the body, it is on your in your soul realm. Psalms 92 verse 16 talks about you and I made without imperfection. 1 John chapter 1 verse 5 talks about there is no darkness in us when God created us. So if God created us without any darkness, if God created us without any imperfection, where did this evil come from? You know, before the flood, you know what was the lifespan of human beings? The lifespan of human beings was 900 to 1000 years. Adam lived nearly 900 years. If the lifespan of Adam was 900 years, that means the teenage years of the people of those time is about 150 to 300 years. We find it hard. Teenagers, okay, 15 to 20, okay, we'll manage. 150 to 300 years of teenage life? That means 300 years you're stuck in adolescence? Oh, I'm finding it difficult with my little girl. No, I'm not talking about my girl. In other words, it could be several years of adolescence and youthfulness. And we are dominated by this, during this time, we are dominated by the selfish desires. Thus, because it is so many years of youthfulness and selfishness, this evil impulse of sin can be permanent after 150 to 300 years in one's heart. After the flood, the time span reduced, okay? Till the flood, it was 900 years, but after the flood, it was reduced to 120 years, okay? So that's a different topic of its own. So I'm just asking us to think during those days. So the formation of man's heart is evil from his youth because it is the formation of man's thought that caused his heart to be in evil. If you look at Genesis 8:21, and if you look at Genesis 6:5, we looked at Genesis 8:21. Let's look at Genesis 6:5. Genesis 6:5. The Lord saw the man's wickedness was widespread on the earth, and that every scheme his mind thought was nothing but evil all the time. So, in other words, the imagination of man's heart was evil. What is the imagination? Imagination is the ability to form images and sensations in the mind that are not perceived by external senses such as smell, taste, or touch that are in external. This imagination is coming from within. This imagination is concealed within oneself. That's why if you go to an architect and you tell an architect, I want you to build, or I want you to draw. So where does the drawing begin from? The drawing begins from his mind internally, and then it begins externally. Then he puts it on the blueprint, and finally, once it is approved blue in the blueprint, it is manifest in the external world physically in the form of a house. Have you seen the blueprint of a house? And sometimes some of us, when you look at the blueprint, we don't understand head or tail. But when the architect looks at it, he knows what it is. This is the bedroom, this is the living room, this is the study room. But when we see it, it is just a drawing, a square and blocks. It doesn't make sense. If we really have to make sense, it has to come into effect in the physical world. So that's the same way with sin. Thoughts of sin first originate in the mind, and they form within a person's thoughts. Genesis 6:5 says, Hashem saw the wickedness. God saw the wickedness of man was great upon the earth, and every impulse or formation of thought was evil. What's wrong with this man? All his thoughts are evil, and God saw, and the Bible says in the Hebrew that God saw the formation of his thoughts. You know, this thing about these thoughts, nobody can see it. That's why I say, when God looks at us, it's better than an X-ray machine. X-ray can only see the physical, but these thoughts, it's like this highway only God can see. And the Bible tells us a transformation occurred within man spiritually following the flood. That the evil inclination was installed into man with a greater force of evil than before the flood. After the flood, the evil inclination was increased. The lifespan of man was decreased. Then there were 900 years. Now, after the flood, it is 120 years. Now, just think. Like I said, 900 years. It took them 150 to 300 years just to overcome their youthful lust. Now, if the lifespan is decreased to 120 years, all their life, they're just beating around with the youthful lust. That's why certain people till today struggle with certain things for such a long time. And we don't understand the root of it extends forward into time. Unless you and I come from the lineage of Abraham, who changed the game during those days. What did Abraham do? He came from an evil society, but the Bible says that Abraham uprooted himself from his home, his father's home, his family, and he said, I don't want to do anything with my form, with my culture, with my time. I want to get into this new thing. What is this new thing? Keeping God in focus. That's why the Bible talks about it's important as believers in Messiah to be grafted into Abraham. Why do we be grafted into Abraham? Because Abraham was an idol worshiper. And amidst of this, he came to know God. And he said, I want to come out of my idolatry and I want to walk in the ways of God. Now we need to understand this very well. We are created with good inclination and bad inclination. In other words, you and I were created, we have both the good impulse and the evil impulse. Are you with me? As it says in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, we have the desire to incline ourselves to whatever direction we so desire. We are composed of two bodies, a physical body and a spiritual body. Our soul leans towards the spiritual, while the body leans towards the physical and the material. And the more the physical prevails, the more the soul is darkened, and by the darkening of the soul, the evil inclination prevents us from drawing close to God. When I'm talking about the spiritual and physical, it represents the two separate impulses within us. I'm not just talking about the physical body. I'm not talking about the physical body. I'm talking about the different impulses that live within us. Genesis chapter 2 verse 7 says that God formed us with a different impulse. And the youthful lust comes from the evil impulse that was in us. And the reason why we refer to the evil impulse as, and you know, in other words, this is what happened. When God created us, you and I had an animal soul according to the Bible, but also God breathed his beast inside of us.
the evil was only outside. And but the minute Adam and Eve sinned, the evil which was outside came into our soul and our soul got corrupted. Are you with me? That's why even though we have a soul like the animals, we behave worse than animals. Why do I say we behave worse than animals? Have you seen a tiger smoking pot? Have you seen a bear or grizzly bear going to the closest alcohol store and drinking alcohol? We are worse than them because we behave worse than them. But each of us has an opportunity to overcome. So we are composed of both the spiritual and the physical. What does the physical mean? Physical does not mean just the flesh is evil. I'm not saying this body is evil. I'm saying there is this invisible line, there is this invisible clothing that binds us together, the physical and the spiritual. It causes the physical and the spiritual causes us to pull towards the selfishness that is within us. And what is the selfishness? It is the impulsive. How many of you seen a dead man? Have you seen a dead man? A dead body? You take a dead body, will a dead body be tempted by women? A beautiful woman. She's so beautiful. She has all whatever you dream of. Will the dead body respond? Will the dead body respond to fancy cars? A cool thing. Will the dead body, you take him to the bank, you see a lot of money, and when the body sees a lot of money, does the dead body, it begins to shake? It doesn't shake. Why? Because it's dead. If you are dead in Christ, you should not be responding to the things of the evil or responding to the things of the flesh. I'm not saying that money is evil. I'm not saying that you should not. When you love all these things more than God, then it is evil. The physical body or the flesh is the inner impulse, the animal soul within us. It is that which causes us to act like animals. See what it says, Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. Genesis chapter 2, verse 7 teaches us some very important thing. I want us to get this. It teaches us that we possess a soul similar to the animals. And it talks about there is a part of man's makeup that is similar to animals. But even though we are similar to animals, you know what the good thing is? We are different. We are not animals. Okay? See what it says. It says that God formed man from the dust of the ground. And then he says, he blew a piece of himself into man. The Hebrew over there is Nishmat Chaim. He blew a piece of himself into man. And then man became a living being. Then when God created us, he created us with an animal soul. But what makes us different is the breath of God that is within us. It's that word living being is the same Hebrew word that is used for animals, which is used for birds, which we can find in Genesis chapter 1, verse 20 and 21. That's all it says. So in other words, the animal kingdom is called Nefesh Kaya, that is living beings, and man is called also Nefesh Kaya, that is living beings. We both possess a similar form of makeup in life. But what makes us different is Nishmat Chaim. What is Nishmat Chaim? A piece of God within you. Hallelujah. Now you should be really happy because you don't have to behave like animals. You are different. You and I are different. Why? Because a piece of God. When I say piece of God, literally God blew himself into you. Just because we have an animal soul, it doesn't mean we can prove Darwin's theory. We don't come from monkeys. Okay? So while the evil inclination pertains to our animal soul, we are not limited to the animal kingdom. Because Genesis chapter 2 verse 7 talks about the Nefesh Kaya, which means that you and I have something, a different makeup. We are spiritually not the same as animals. Okay? So it is the animal soul that is within us that is responsible for the youthful lust and evil.
and the animal soul is transmitted genetically, materially at the time of conception. So how do I get it? I get it at the time of conception. Where did I all begin? It all began from the time Adam and Eve started to disobey God. So you say, so then it's not my fault. Well, it's not technically your fault, but you and I still have a responsibility to do something about it. You can either cut it off like Abraham cut it off, or you can continue and be like Cain and behave like Cain. See what Psalms 51 verse 7 says. For Psalms 51 verse 7, the psalmist says something very incredible. He says that I was conceived in my mother's womb in sin. Isn't that amazing? So this idea of the imaginations of man, these imaginations of man are the imaginations of evil, and it comes from its youth, it comes from his soul. The divine soul of man that is blown into man is joined along with the animal soul that is joined through the blood. So how does the both of the animal soul, how does the divine soul get joined together? It gets connected through the blood. Okay, I'm going to talk to you about the blood very soon. Very soon we're going to come to it. Okay, let's see. When man sinned, he caused evil to increase through his animal soul, both in himself and in his creation. You need to understand, when Adam sinned, he caused an concealment of perfection, and it increased evil by the sin of Adam from Genesis onward. So man is basically responsible for the evil that exists within him, and he's also very responsible for the evil around him. That is why man finds it very difficult to overcome the evil. So what do we do? It is very important for us to draw closer to God, because only God can help us overcome the evil within and without. Everybody with me? Now, Genesis chapter 8 verse 21 talks about this youth. The evil comes from the youth. Can we read that verse again? Genesis chapter 8 verse 21, it says that man's impulsive evil is from his youth. You know, that word youth in Hebrew comes another two more times in the Bible. This exact Hebrew word comes only two more times, altogether three times in the Bible. One is found in Genesis chapter 8 verse 21. Second is found in 1 Samuel chapter 17 verses 33, where Saul is telling David that, you know, when he's going to fight Goliath, that Goliath is a man of war since his youth. And the third time, it is found in Jeremiah chapter 48 verse 11, where it describes the nature of Moab, that Moab has been at ease from his youth. How many of you know anything about Moab? Moab is basically, he's come into existence through incest, with the relationship with Lot's daughter, with himself. Moab was a problem to the Midianites and the Moabites during the time of Balak, and he seduced the Jews into sexual sin. That is why most of the Moabites could not enter into the covenant of God except Ruth. That is why we begin to see that here in Jeremiah chapter 48, it talks about the nature of Moab. In these three passages, it teaches us something about you. It teaches us that from our youth, we must wage war against the evil inclination in order to overcome the evil within our hearts. Let's read that passage in 1 Samuel 17:33. 1 Samuel chapter 17 verse 33, where it talks about the youth. So Goliath was a man of war from his youth. The word for man over there in the Hebrew is called Ish. You know what Ish is? Ish is basically man. But was Goliath a man? He was a giant, so why do you call this man a man? So here, Saul is not just talking about Goliath. He's talking something deeper. What is he saying? He's saying that the very root of Goliath existed before you came into existence. So the enemy you're fighting is not just a physical enemy. The enemy you're fighting is a more different enemy. It is a spiritual enemy.
And the spiritual enemy cannot be fought in the physical. That is why the Bible says that when David goes against Goliath, he does not say that I'm afraid of Goliath. He says, you know, he that is in me is greater than he that is in Goliath. Are you with me? So he's saying you're not fighting an individual. You're fighting an enemy of your soul that existed many, many years ago that began from the time of Adam. How do I fight it? You can't fight it with flesh or blood. You can only fight it with the Spirit of God. Are you with me? If you have ever taken time to read Deuteronomy chapter 29, Deuteronomy chapter 30, it all talks about the heart. It talks about the heart that goes astray. It talks about the heart that needs to be circumcised. It talks about the heart. 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 See what it says, Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 17. I'm going to come to the best part. Hold on, okay? Deuteronomy chapter 9, verse 17. 29, not 9, 29. Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 17. You have seen their abomination of and their idols of wood, stone, silver and gold which they had with them, so that there will not be among you a man or woman or family or tribe there will not be a root that bears gall and wormwood. What is the meaning of that? It's basically talking about a person who has a very dark lifestyle. He's talking about a root that is there within you, a root flourishing that makes the heart to go astray, a root flourishing that makes the heart to go away from God, a root flourishing that says that I don't want to do anything with the God of the Bible. I want to go and worship the God of the Gentiles. When the Bible talks about Gentiles, here it uses the word goy. And what does goy mean? It is a man or a woman who has not dealt with their animalistic soul, their evil impulse. That is a Gentile. It says such a root, such a person is led away because of the deceitful heart, because of the evil impulse within one's heart. The reason one is going and worshiping other God is because of the root of gall and wormwood. Let's go on to verse number 19. What does it say? When he hears the words of this curse, and the implication of what the Bible says, he's saying, you know what is he saying? He's going to bless himself in his heart and says, peace be with me. I will walk as my heart seems fit. In other words, this man is going away and worshiping other gods, but yet he comes into the community of God and he says, I have perfect peace. I'm sinning with all of my heart, but I'm coming into the house of God. And you know what I'm saying? I will do what I want to do, however I want to do, and I don't care whatever you have to say. I don't care about the fool who stands here on Saturday and Sunday and tells you what to do. Because I want to do what I want to do anyway. I want to do it my way. I'm going to decide how I'm going to do it, and I'm going to disagree with everything you say. I won't open my Bible, and even if I open my Bible, I don't care what it says. I'm just going to do what I want to do, as I want to do, when I'm going to do, where I want to do, except listen to what the Bible says, and except listen to the one who talks to you today. Are you with me? See, what's the warning? The warning in Deuteronomy chapter 29 is, if you and I don't control our desires before we are overpowered with the lustful lust,
youthful lust, because once we give into our curiosity, which the Creator has said not to get into, these carvings begin to increase and increase and increase and overpower. It's like this. Porn. I just watch it 1 minute. Second day, 1 minute is not enough. 2 minutes. Third day, 2 minutes is not enough. 3 minutes. 5 minutes. 10 minutes. I just want to watch for a little time. It goes on. And men and women watch this for hours together without sleep, without anything, because what they have experienced in the beginning, they have not canceled it in the beginning. They have not stopped it in the beginning. They have entertained it. They have continued it. And because they continued the evil, the little is not enough. I want more. I want more. I want more. It's the same thing with drugs. I just want to try a little. I just want to have this feeling. How many of us stop with that feeling? I just want to smoke once. I just want to drink once. I just want to do this once. I just want to experience once in my lifetime. I just want to experience it. It's the same thing with anger. It's the same thing with bitterness. It's the same thing with anything. The more youthful lust increase, the more weaker we become. The more the physical and the material increase, the more the soul becomes darker, because the physical or the material desires to take us away from the things that cause us to draw closer to God. Blood serves as a medium between the divine image of God we are created in and through the animalistic aspect. Listen to this quote. It is the animalistic ass soul which is responsible for man's youthful lust in and evil. The animalistic ass soul is transmitted through the genetic material at the time of conception. The animalistic soul is responsible for the imagination within man. As the Bible says in Genesis chapter 8 verse 21, that man's thought is evil from his youth. The image of God was joined to the man's lower aspect, and that is the soul, through the blood. So the question is, why is the heart deceitful? Yeshua clearly says the heart is deceitful because of the evil impulses. Where did these evil impulses come? The evil impulses came from our animal soul. The reason why the blood is linked between the image of God and the soul, animal soul, is that specific organs within man are network connections to the soul. Have you ever taken time to read the book of Leviticus? It's a very interesting book, because you know what it talks about? Give the heart, give the liver, give the fats. And you say, what the hell is the Bible talking about? Heart, liver, kidneys. Who wants to hear about all these things? Okay, let's see. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9 and 10. Jeremiah chapter 17. Are you learning something? Okay, it says over here that the heart is deceitful above all and frail. Who can know it? When the Bible is talking about the heart, is it talking about the left ventricle or the right ventricle? What is it talking about? Verse number 10. It says, I, the Lord, examine the heart, and I test what? And I test, some Bible says actions, some Bible says innermost thoughts, some Bible says inwards. But do you know what the Hebrew says? All these English translations are very poor. You know what the Hebrew says? The Hebrew says, I test the kidneys. Yes, because in Hebrew it is the word kelayot, kelef. God is testing the heart and the kidneys to give man according to his ways, the fruit according to his deeds.
It's the same translation in Jeremiah chapter 20 verse 12. Let's see that. Jeremiah chapter 20 verse 12. See what happens over there. Jeremiah chapter 20 verse 12. Yes. You see, in this Bible, KJV says he sees the reins, and what does it say over there? He sees what? The mind, or some other Bible says he sees the inwards. You know what the Hebrew says? It doesn't say inwards, it doesn't say reins, it doesn't say the mind. It says he sees the kidneys. Jeremiah chapter 11 verse 20. What does he see? He tests what? The Lord tests the heart, and it's not the mind. It's poor translation. It's the kidneys. So what is the Lord testing? He's testing your heart and your kidneys. Every organ in your body is connected to every organ that you offer as a sacrifice at the altar of God. Every animal you give unto God is a reason. There is you. God is not just, okay, you bring a bull, you bring a goat, you bring a dove. God's not doing that. Ini, bini, mine, amo. He's not doing that. Everything, there is a connection. Everything, there is a reason. Are you with me? It is the whole concept of kidneys that are used in Genesis chapter 17, Jeremiah chapter 17, Jeremiah chapter 20, Jeremiah chapter 11, heart and kidneys. Because according to Jeremiah, when God analyzes a person, he examines the heart and the kidneys. Why? Why does he examine the heart and the kidneys? Because Hashem, God, is a great physician. He checks the depths of man's innermost beings. Psalms 7 verse 10. Psalms 7 verse 10. See what it talks about God. The psalmist says, 7 verse 10. Verse 11. Yes, it says that he is the searcher of the hearts and minds. He is the righteous God. It's not the mind over there. Verse number 10 and 11. You know, the reason the verses are different for me is because I'm reading the Hebrew Bible, okay? It's different from the English Bible, that's why. So it says, verse number 10 talks that he searches the heart and the mind. It's not the mind, it's the kidneys. Now, listen to what the sages say. The sages say, the kidneys are counselors and the heart considers. The kidneys are counselors that the heart considers. Each organ functions as a network connection and corresponds to your and my soul. A person has two kidneys, one of which counsels them to do good, the other which counsels him to do evil. And it is reasonable that the good one is to the right and the evil one is to the left, for it is written in Ecclesiastes chapter 10 verse 12, the heart of the wise man is to his right, but the heart of the fool is to his left. So the concept of the two kidneys representing the two forces within man corresponding to the concept of good impulse and evil impulse is literally here. So what's the idea? Two kidneys, right one good, left one bad. Now, after listening to this message, if anybody wants you to go to the doctor and tell the doctor, please remove my left kidneys. Why? Because the pastor said it's evil. You really need to come and talk to me. I need to pray for you. Because you have not got the point. What is the point? The structure of man is designed in a specific way to correspond to the soul, and everything in us is placed in a perfect design because it relates to the soul, and the soul is the primary aspect of man, so every organ relates to the soul. The kidneys communicate. How do the kidneys communicate to the brain? It communicates to the brain via the nervous system. You know, those of us who have fight and flight response. You know what's a fight and flight response? Your baby is about to fall. Moms, what do you do? That's an instinct. It is something that God created with you. It is a good thing. But you know the problem with us? With the work schedule, we are always on this. Always. That is bad. When that is at all times, you know what happens? It kills your immune system. Are you with me? Once in a while, it is okay. That's how God created you. Somebody is going to kill you. You come and defend yourself and hit him back. That's why you need to learn self-defense. You don't know self-defense, talk to Anil about it. He'll help you about it. Don't just stand there and do nothing. Oh, I am a poor victim. No. You are called to defend yourself. Somebody is trespassing you, especially girls. A guy is doing something, don't just say, oh, are you a papa? No, are you a papa? Give him one. Because he has no right to do that. We'll see later. If we go to jail, we'll look at that later. Now, defend yourself. Are you with me? Don't think that I am the weakling. You're not the weakling. You are made in the image of God. Amen. See what it says. So it's about the heart and the kidneys. Let's see. Leviticus. Let's read the book of Leviticus. Leviticus 17:11. Leviticus 7:11 says what? 17:11. Correct. 17:11. The soul of the flesh is in the blood. Kidneys communicate with the brain via the nervous system. When it says that the soul of the flesh is in the blood, this is a reference to the nervous system. It is not talking about our RBC and our WBC. Because the only thing that flows through the nerves is neuropulses, and that is considered the life of the brain, which is the seat of the soul in man, because all mental activities depend on neurological impulses. You know what Proverbs chapter 23 verse 7 says? As a man thinks, so is he. You know in the literal Hebrew what it says? It doesn't say that. It says, as a person estimates in his soul, so he exists. It's not the thinking, it's the soul. So the concept of thinking with the heart is related to the mental processing power of the animal soul transmitted through the neurological impulses. The microscope reveals the connection between the kidneys and the brain. Microcirculation, macrocirculation, what connects the heart and the kidneys and the brain together. And the nerves serve as a highway for the soul to communicate within man. In other words, the kidneys, the heart, and the brain are organs which has two hemispheres, left and right. Man is composed of a left and right nature. Representation of the impulsive evil and representation of the impulsive good. And the Bible says that God examines the heart. He is not literally examining the right or the left ventricle. Rather, he's examining what? He's examining the intentions of your soul. He's examining the choices you and I are making. And he's examining if those choices are good or evil. If we choose evil, which is the ego, the selfish desire, the physical and the material world will overtake the spiritual, then we are causing blockage in our spiritual arteries. That means we are about to have a spiritual heart attack. Are you with me? If you read the book of Leviticus, Leviticus is a book that is very, very detailed. And do you know what the Bible says? The Bible says that three things you have to put at the altar. Number one, the fats, the choices, fats, and the blood. Those are the only three things that you're supposed to put at the altar. Fats, choices, fats, and altar. That's why you and I are not supposed to eat the fats, the choices, fats, and the blood. The Hebrew word for blood is dam, and blood is it represents willpower, which in Hebrew is ratzon. The Hebrew word for fat is kelev, which means desire. So the blood represents willpower, and the fat represents the desire. And God says, both these things I want you to put at my altar. When the blood and the fat are poured out on the altar, that is symbolic of the fire representing God's spirit consuming your flesh and selfish desire, you're basically giving yourself unto God and say, God, it's not me, but I want you to live in me. I'm giving up my will, I'm giving up my desire, I'm giving up what I want, and I want to give it over to you, and I want the Spirit of God to consume within me. So when you bring an offering before God, it is not just an external offering, it is an offering that you're giving from within yourself, because you are supposed to be at the altar, and in my place I'm offering an animal, and I'm giving that part of the animal and saying, God, take my heart, take my will, take my blood, take everything, and I want to follow you. Where do these thoughts come from? These thoughts come from our imagination. And Deuteronomy talks about a person who is going his own way, doing whatever he wants. But he's saying, shalom with me, peace with me, because I will do as my heart fits. Nobody can tell me anything. I'm going to do what I want to do, because the thoughts that propel me causes me to do what I want to do. Are you understanding what I'm trying to say? I don't want to listen to anybody. I don't want to do anything. I don't want to give my heart. I don't want to give my desire. I don't want to give my anything. I want to give myself. I don't want to do anything. My willpower, my desire, it's all for me. I will do what I want to do, how I want to do, when I want to do, where I want to do. In the beginning, we started by talking about Cain and Abel. We'll conclude by Cain and Abel. Let me ask you a question. They said that Cain killed Abel with a stone. It's not a gun problem, it's a heart problem. But the question is, what did Cain actually kill Abel with? The Bible does not tell us the weapon. Let's see, Genesis chapter 4. Genesis 4, 8. It says that Cain spoke to his brother Abel. After that, the scene in the Bible changes. He spoke and then it changes. What happens? And it happened when they were in the field that Cain rose against his brother Abel and killed him. The Bible does not give us the murder weapon. We don't know if it was a bone, a stone, or anything, or a gun, or an AK-47. We don't know anything. All the Bible says is how he was killed. It says that Cain talked to his brother. Cain used speech to lure his brother into the field. And the sages say it was to murder him in secret. Why to murder him in secret? Because the murder didn't come from outside. It came from his thoughts within. So where did Cain kill Abel first? Cain killed Abel first in his heart. In secret. In secret, I go and talk in my living room. In secret, I go and talk in my bedroom. In secret, I go and talk about X, Y, and Z. In secret, I talk, and by doing so, I murder my brother and my sister. Nobody sees it. That's what we do, isn't it? In the living room, in my kitchen, in my bedroom, secretly. The story of Cain and Abel is not just an historical story. It is a story to represent the impulsive evil and the impulsive good. Cain represents the impulsive evil and Abel represents the impulsive good. Genesis 4:8 says that Cain caused Abel to be in the field with his speech. This is the function of the impulsive evil. It is to use the enticement of the flesh to lure you into seclusion, to be private. And after you're private, I will kill you. Listen carefully. You're married, no? Shanti is not behaving well with you. That girl in the office, she's doing good. Let's go out with her. Let's just forget about it. He starts by whispering to you.
And after he whispers to you, he takes you to the field of seclusion. What is the field of seclusion? I don't want to tell anything to anybody. It's a secret. Don't tell pastor. Don't tell anybody. Just keep it to yourself. Why does he tell you not to tell anybody? Why does he want you to keep your things in the secret? Because he wants to snuff you out spiritually. The reason many are dying spiritually is because we keep things privately. We don't want to expose the secret of our heart or the secret of our home, because if we expose it, somebody will look down on me. It is the secret of the thoughts that are generated from within that causes us to be separated from God. The desire, now this statement you have to listen very carefully. It says, the desire of the Satan is no less natural than man's desire to indulge in youthful lust. Man must free himself from the youthful lust to enable the Satan, that enables the Satan to seduce him before God can come into his assistance to shield him against the seducer. He's saying that man must free himself from the youthful lust that enables the Satan to seduce him before God can come into his assistance. In other words, if you want God's help in your life, you have to do something first. What is that something? James says, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. What do you mean by submit to God? Say, Lord, here am I. I'm a sinner. I need your help. I need your provision. Help me. And with his help, he helps you overcome the evil that is within you. And when you overcome the evil within you, you can ask God for help to help the evil to around you to go. Are you with me? The Bible says that when Abel and Cain brought an offering before God, it says that Cain brought the fruits of the earth in Genesis chapter 4 verse 3. But Abel brought the choicest fats of his firstborn. Abel brought the choicest fats. What is the choicest fats? The kalev, which refers to the kidney within the sheep. Cain brought an inferior portion of his crops, but Abel brought the choicest fats of his flock to God. Abel brought the fats, whereas but what happened? Cain brought the cheap thing. The fat represents the desire. The blood represents the willpower. Abel gave his desire and willpower to God. Cain said, I will do as I want, however I want, wherever I want. It's up to me. The word for ground or earth in the Hebrew is adama. Inside the word adama is the word dam, which means blood. The word for fat is kelev. Inside the word kelev is the word lev, which means heart. Are you with me? Cain just gave inferior, but Abel gave important. Because Cain did not fully submit his will before Hashem. His offering was rejected, but Abel submitted his choices, desire before God. And the Bible says he was accepted. See what it says in Genesis chapter 4 verse 7. After this offering is over, see what God is telling Cain. If you do well, won't your countenance be lifted up? Sin sits at the door. Sin sits at the opening. Oh, door of what? Opening of what? Sin is sitting at the opening or the door of your soul. And what does sin want to do? Sin wants to conquer you. You have the power to overcome it. But you need to say, I want to overcome. You can't say, oh, I had no control. No. That's the biggest lie. You have no control. I was just angry and it just came out. It didn't come out.
you didn't submit yourself to God. Psalms 81 says that you must not harbor a strange God within you. It teaches that as long as the attitudes that appeal to the Satan, the seducer, is still within us, God cannot help us. If there is deception within us, we are not doing anything to get rid of the deception. God himself cannot help you and do anything for your life. But you're saying, what do you mean God cannot help us? You know what I mean by God cannot help us? It's not that God cannot help us. He can help us. He cannot do anything against your willpower, because you are saying, I don't want to do anything with God. I just want to do what my heart wants to do, however I want to do, and I don't want anybody to help me. And in such situations, God also will not interfere within anybody. Some people say, but Pastor, I'm not such a bad person. I'm not going out there to the pub and doing all these bad things. You know, Cain also was not such a bad person. He was a good guy. He just secretly took his brother. There's this book called The Path of the Just. And in this book, this is an interesting quote. It says, if our service is not to increase the glory of God, we are doing it wrong. If our service is not to do the glory of God, then we are doing it wrong. In other words, a person could serve God day and night. They are not doing any type of sins. They are not committing any type of sins. But yet, if their worship is intermingled with stuff that takes us away from God and not giving God the glory, then you and I are in sin. Or else, in anything you do, Is it bringing glory to God? If it is not bringing glory to God, then you and I are sinning. The enemy tries to intermingle our worship of God with something else that is not God. He seduces us. He makes us think, you know what? I'm Mr. and Mrs. Righteous. I'm not as bad as you think. I'm a good guy. That person, Sandeep, he's the evil one. He's the sinner. I'm good. I'm not doing even half the things he is doing. But you know what? While the whole time you're thinking like that, you are blinded by the enemy. And he's secluding you, and he's taking you away private, and he's going to destroy you very soon. It's the same thing with your marriage. In your marriage, does it bring glory to God? In your spouse's life, does it bring glory to God? With your children, does it bring glory to God? In your job, does it bring glory to God? In your free time, does it bring glory to God? If it is not increasing the glory of God in your life, you and I are sinning. Anything I do. Deuteronomy chapter 29 verse 10 says that you are standing before God. And as you're standing before God this morning, I want to ask the question, what is the condition of your heart? When was the last time you went for a checkup to this great physician and asked this physician, search my heart? When was the last time that you said, I have a serious heart problem, search me, deal with my problem? The Bible says that God probes and analyzes the heart, the inner parts of man. No x-ray machine, no CAT scan, no PET scan, no any scan can do what God does. When he sees between. And when God looks us at this morning, where are we standing before God? Are you with me, friends? In Deuteronomy, the Bible talks about when God is telling, Moses is telling Israel that in Deuteronomy chapter 8 verse 2, that Hashem your God led you these 40 years in the wilderness to afflict you, to test you. Why did God afflict and test you? To see what is in your heart, to do that. He deliberately did all this to expose what is in your heart. Have you allowed your heart to be blocked because of youthful lust? You say, Pastor, I'm not youth anymore. That's not the point. Did you have this thought? I need more money. I need more income. I have a lust for little more rupees in my hand. I wish I had that little more extra income in my hand. The question is, why do you want that extra income? To fulfill what? Why do you want that extra income? Is it just to meet your needs and to give to God, or for something else? That means you're not God focused, you're money focused. I've been wanting to get married. I waited all this time. This girl, she looks pretty. She wears whatever I have wanted her to wear. She speaks English. Let him who has ears, let him hear and understand. This person is good looking, but this person's heart is not with God. God tests us with certain people. God tests us with certain things to see what is in our heart. In other words, God allows certain people, things, situations to come into our life to make sure that we see the condition of our own heart. As a man thinks, so is he. As a man estimates, that is where his soul is at his life. I replace God with person. I replace God with my money. I replace God with others. These are all, whatever I replace God with is a youthful lust. God told Cain that the enemy is at your door. That is, the enemy is at the opening of your soul, but you can still conquer him. You, tell your neighbor, you. It's not convincing enough to your neighbor. Tell your neighbor, you. Hey, that's not convincing. I don't think your neighbor is convinced. He or she is not convinced that he or she can conquer it. Tell your neighbor, you can conquer it. Hallelujah. Do you believe that? Israel is called a kingdom of priests. As children of the king, we need to emulate what the king, the attributes of the king is. You know what's the Hebrew word for king? The Hebrew word for king is Melech. It is an acronym of three words. One, Mem for Mocha. That is basically the mind or brain. Lamed for heart, lev, and Kaved for liver. Melech stands for mind, heart, and liver. Mind, heart is your liver. It has to be in this order. You know, if it is in the other order, if you turn around the words of Melech, it is the word Kelum, and you know what Kelum means? Nothing. If God is not king, he is not king of your mind, your heart, and your liver, that means you are nothing. You know, animals also follow the same sequence: brain, heart, and liver. When they get depressed, they don't want to commit suicide. When they feel bad, they don't want to run away. But what happens to us? Nobody loves me. Nobody cares for me. Everybody is against me. Such a pity party. The animals behave better than us. Man is called the king of the beasts. We are the cream of the crop of creation. We call ourselves what? Homo sapiens. You know what Homo sapiens literally means? This is interesting. Homo sapiens literally means wise man. Really? It's funny, but we don't even behave one bit wise in terms of God. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, you know what God tells Moses, Joshua, keep this book of the law with you, meditate on it day and night, and when you meditate on it day and night, then you will be successful in everything you do. How do I meditate? It all begins by my mouth. I take this word and I confess it. When I confess it, it renews my mind. When it renews my mind, it changes my heart. When it changes my heart, the dirt of my kidneys are given up to God. In order to be a true king, in order to be a true king in your home, in order to be a true king in your business, in order to be a true king in whatever you do, first of all, you need to be guided by the actions of spiritual maturity. The seat of the soul is in the mind. What does that mean? If I want to rule like the King of Kings that I'm created by, then I need to cause this word to get into my mind. How do I get it? I need to open my Bible every day, read it, confess it, and then my mind begins to be changed. The problem with us, I'm too much in the world and I don't have time for God. How will I renew it? God can help you overcome your attitudes or the enemy of soul only if you allow or you overcome the enemy that prevails with you. See what Colossians, we're going to close with this. No, we'll close with this. Deuteronomy chapter 30 verse 6. It says that God will circumcise your heart. Friends, this circumcision can be done only by Yeshua the Messiah. But for this circumcision to take place, I have to go before God and say, here am I. I'm struggling. I'm in sin. I have a sin problem. I have an anger problem. I have a lust problem. I have a selfish problem. I have an arrogant problem. I have a pride problem. Whatever your problem is, I need to go before God and confess it before God and say, Lord, here am I. Without you, I can do nothing. So please, oh God, help me. Revelation chapter 3 verse 15 and 16 says that I know your works, you're neither cold or hot. I wish you were either cold or hot, but what are you? You are lukewarm. Because you are lukewarm and because you're neither hot and cold, God says, I'm going to throw you out. I'm going to spit you out. What's the problem? You're not cold. You're not hot. You're in this between. What is in between? I will take things from God. I will take things from the world. I will mingle it together. And I'll say, it is peace. It is well with my soul. In my heart, in my kidneys, in my innermost being, I will do whatever I want to do. But I come for worship on Saturday and Sunday. And I say, Lord, I give you my heart. You're not giving God anything. You're just giving nothing. That's why you're not ruling like kings and queens on the earth. You're ruling as nothingness. How many of us are struggling with the same old sin again and again and again and again and again and again and again in your life? Because you say, I have given it over to God. But when it comes to taking time to do things what God's word tells us to do, we don't do because I'm not focused on God. Why? Because I'm busy. What am I busy? I'm working. Why am I working? I need money. God, all this is good. I'm not telling you not to work. I'm saying, but in the midst of all this working, do you have time to give to the Lord? Do you give yourself to God? 7 days into 24 hours is how much? 7 into 24. Any mathematicians? 160? 168 hours in a week. Out of that, how much do you give to God? 2 hours in church on a Sunday to listen to God's word. And then I say, I'm not able to overcome. You know why you're not able to overcome? You don't take time in this word of God. It all begins with your mind. You receive the word, accept the word, believe the word, meditate on the word, start confessing the word. And as you do that, it changes your heart. Then you change your heart. Then you begin to recognize the filth in your kidneys and your all your areas. And you say, Lord, I want to give my willpower to you. I want to give myself to you. I want to give everything that is within me with you. I just want to give it over to you. Are you with me, my friend? My desire. Kidneys represent my desire. I want this. I want that. I wish I had this. I wish I had that. Are you willing to give your desire? So, Pastor, are you saying that I should not have a desire? I'm not saying that. Is your desire a godly desire? Is your desire something that comes from the throne room of God? Yes, our highest desire is to be in the Lord. We are created in His image. Are you willing to give your willpower to Him? Are you willing to give your plans to Him? Are you willing to give your aims to Him? I want to do this. Okay, do it. God is not going to stop you. Several young people have told me this in their lives. Pastor, I've not heard anything, but I just want to do it. Is it a bad thing? It's not a bad thing. But God doesn't want you to have it. But still I take it. Why? Because I want it. I want it. I want it. I want so much of money. God will give you so much of money. Why do you want that money? I want a better job. Good. Why do you want a better job? What is your motivation behind it? I'm still struggling with anger problem, selfish problem, lying problem, pride problem, arrogant problem. I don't want to deal with any of these things. You know, when the Lord looks into our hearts, He looks beyond the flesh. He looks into that. He's the searcher of the innermost. Are we willing to give our desires, our willpower, and our thoughts to God and say, God, I want to change this thought. How do I change this thought? The only way I can change this thought, by getting the word into my mind. How do I get the word? Read the word. If you can't read the word, plug in the audio Bible and allow the audio Bible to run. You know, you take hours together putting the earphones on your ears instead of hearing to Kon Banega Karodpadi or whatever nonsense you want to listen to. And you can listen to the word of God. Listen to it. Pastor, what happens when I keep on listening to it? My mind begins to change. My mind begins to think the ways of God. And my mind begins to think the ways of God. Then my brain gives command to my heart. Respond to the word of God. And the Bible says that faith comes by hearing. And when the faith begins to come, I can look at my stomach and says, I know it is difficult, but with God's help, I can go beyond, because He that is in me is greater than he that is in the world. You and I are not called to live the natural. You and I are not to limit yourself in the salary you get. If you live by the salary you get, you're not living according to God's word. Yes, you have a salary. Yes, you have to live within your budget. But I'm saying, don't just live according to your salary. Live according to the provision of the greatness of God and God's word. Yeshua said, birds have nests. The Son of Man, the wolves have, foxes have holes, but the Son of Man has no place. He didn't have house, he didn't have bungalow, but he did whatever he was supposed to do in his lifetime. In the limited time you and I on this earth, are we doing what we are supposed to do? You might not have a bungalow, you might not have a Porsche, you might not have a Benz, you might not have anything, but are you doing what God is wanting you to do, and you're fulfilling the will of God in your lifetime? Praise God, continue, move on. The sages says that if you don't overcome the evil within you and don't ask God to help give you help, He Himself will not help you. Submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. So before we close for this morning and before Yom Kippur comes, I really pray that we would give ourselves to God and say, here am I, Lord. I might have bitterness, I want to deal with it. I might have rejection problem, I want to deal with it. I might have forgiveness problem, I want to deal with it. I might have jealousy problem, I want to deal with it. I might have envy problem, I want to deal with it. I might have abandonment problem, I want to deal with it. I might have fear problem, I want to deal with it. I might have any problem, I want to deal with it. Are you willing to give your plans, your will, your desires to the Lord? Face yourself. Wage war with the enemy of your soul. Judge yourself as God judges you. Because if you do that before Yom Kippur, I can promise you one thing: God will truly prosper you spiritually and physically, because He is truly the blesser of our soul. Let's pray.